thousands of bombs rain down on Afghanistan. The war on terrorism begins. Writer and adventurer Robert Young Pelton is at the front lines.
In a war zone, things are pretty frenetic.
He finds himself at the epicenter of one of the war's most intense and violent battles, and discovers a now infamous American caught fighting for the Taliban.
And an American has been found in the basement of Qali Jangi prison and brought here.
To Pelton, this is a journey to understand one of the world's most dangerous places. Author Robert Young Pelton is on another mission, to witness the war in Afghanistan firsthand. Pelton has decided there's only one man who can make this happen, General Abdul Rashid Dostum.
He was very rarely mentioned in the media without the words brutal warlord or evil warlord in front of his name.
Dostum, a Northern Alliance commander, is targeted by Pelton as the man who will bring him to the front lines of the war. For the author of The World's Most Dangerous Places, Afghanistan is a violent region he understands well, a country that grasps his fascination and drives him back because of the utter beauty of its landscape, the people, and danger.
Well, Afghanistan is one of the most dangerous countries on earth because of a number of reasons. One is that there's ongoing warfare, there's banditry and there's theft. There's also probably one of the higher concentrations of landmines.
Okay, tashakkur.
It's a place where really nothing is for sure. I mean, you really have to have your wits about you because you face all types of dangers, and that's not even including the health dangers.
While his journey is triggered by the dramatic events of 9/11, the lack of news or first-hand witnesses to this new war intrigues and draws Pelton into the conflict.
All I know is that there are Green Berets fighting inside Afghanistan. I don't know if they're winning or losing. All I know is I want to get there and find out.
The trip begins in California, with the first major stop in Frankfurt, Germany. It is a time to ponder his decision, his choices. Time seems to crawl one moment. Then, fully understanding the risks he must take, he plunges into the world's most dangerous place.
In terms of danger, yeah, there was a war going on. There was a lot of aerial bombardments. There was a lot of ground action. So I was not, you know, it's a fairly familiar territory for me. But unless I had something specific to be concerned about, I wouldn't waste my time worrying about it. I don't worry about my own safety because unless I have something tangible to deal with, you know, most of those fears are based on speculation or ignorance. And I always say the most dangerous thing is ignorance. What I was going to do, my goal was simply just to move towards my goal and learn as much as I can as I went along. And if there was a problem, I would deal with it at times. From what I had read about General Dostum, he sounded like a pretty brutal fellow, and he had been famous in the previous fighting for being one of the most, I guess, powerful commanders. He very rarely lost a battle. And the media reports were very, very sketchy. I found maybe one or two articles where somebody had actually met him. And that was even more intriguing to me.
From Frankfurt, he travels to Uzbekistan, Afghanistan's nervous northern neighbor. With more than 200 journalists waiting at the border, their entry into Afghanistan refused, there's no guarantees that Pelton can make it either. But he has his own approach on how to succeed.
The key is you have to build trust. The thing that I find interesting about war zones is that once people realize you're there just to depict what's happening, not necessarily to interpret what's happening, they want you there. They want you to understand why they're fighting. They want you to see the aftermath of warfare because they don't like it. They want it solved. So my goal, I think, is to provide that conduit, you know, that channel for people to communicate what they're doing. I'll let other people judge. I don't necessarily go in with an opinion in mind. I just simply write down what I see, and I let the viewer or the reader make their own decisions.
As Pelton makes his way to the border, General Dostum, with his battle-weary but seasoned army, is fighting his way towards the city of Mazar-i-Sharif, living in caves and raiding Taliban positions on horseback. These soldiers are fighting a desperate guerrilla war in the mountains, now supported by a covert team of Green Berets. Dostum is aware that Pelton wants to meet with him. But the Afghan commanders are leery of journalists after terrorists posing as a film crew assassinated their former leader, Ahmed Shah Massoud. And now Pelton, along with his film crew, intends to convince Dostum to let him enter his inner circle.
You know, with sat phones these days, people can communicate from anywhere in the world, and General Dostum had a sat phone, and the representatives were calling him. But there's never any guarantee that he knows specifically why you're coming or you know, what he should do. I mean, you're typically just giving somebody a heads up, saying, I'm coming there. And at that particular time, the border was closed. And there were something like 200 journalists waiting in Tashkent and Termez for official permission to enter Afghanistan. And the normal route is either by barge or by this bridge called the Friendship Bridge. At that time, the Friendship Bridge was blocked with huge cinder blocks, and the entire bridge was wired with explosives. And the idea of people going into Afghanistan made them very nervous as well. So anybody that went across had to have somebody very senior make a phone call to say, yes, this person can cross. The thing that's funny about journalism these days is that everybody waits for permission. And in a war zone, things are pretty frenetic. And to have a piece of paper or something that says you can do this or can't do that is really not relevant. What you need to be is with people who have the ability to get you there.
Now we're doing super secret photography here. You're not even supposed to film this. They can't see me now. And they would not be happy. But see these little curlicues so the Taliban can't sneak across? Okay, there's our first border guard who doesn't want us filming.
And even with everybody understanding what you're doing, there's always this sort of sense of fear that maybe these people are up to no good or maybe these aren't the right people. So it's never clear that you're going to get across or you aren't going to get across. And a lot of very strange things happen while you're there. People will walk up, look in the car, go away. You'll wait an hour. They'll come back. They'll look at your passport. They'll go away. They'll come back half an hour later. They'll take your passport. But there's nothing in your passport. So it just seems to be the general style of how things are done here.
Negotiations to cross the border go on for the next 4 hours. Finally, an important call comes from Dostum's men. The gates are lifted, and Pelton enters Afghanistan. In the first 2 months of the war, the United States has dropped over 20,000 bombs on Afghanistan, many where Pelton is headed. It's a 2-hour drive south of the Afghan border to the northern capital of Mazar-i-Sharif. It's only days since General Rashid Dostum liberated Mazar, driving the Taliban into the surrounding mountains. Dostum has liberated his headquarters, a 19th century fortress at the edge of Mazar. The fort, called Qali Jangi, will soon become infamous in the war against terrorism.
Adam Lada, you're my son.
4,000 foreign and Taliban prisoners surrender to Dostum and are sent to Qali Jangi. Meanwhile, Pelton is left to explore Mazar, but a firestorm is about to explode.
When you go through the towns here, you see the muddy roads and you see the stalls, and everybody stares as you walk through town, and a lot of people carry guns, so it's very evocative of what we think the Wild West was once.
After 4 years of Taliban oppression, there's an enthusiastic atmosphere in the newly liberated city.
Mazar is a completely different place now that the Taliban have gone. The markets are full of goods, you can hear music, and there's a general sense of optimism. How much?
How many 120.
Holy cow!
Just 100.
That evening, Pelton is taken to a guest house close to Qali Jangi where the prisoners are being kept. With nightfall, mortar rounds and bombs echo throughout the countryside. The fort is under attack. Pelton has arrived at the front lines of the war.
We're just standing outside the guest house where we're staying, about a mile from an old fort where Taliban prisoners were kept. Earlier today, there was an incident in which both local and American soldiers were involved in a firefight. And from what we understand, one American was killed, and a number of Northern Alliance troops were also killed. At 11 o'clock tonight, we started hearing the sound of gunfire. And what is happening now is there's been a number of bombing runs and fighting.
From the night vision of a gunship circling Qali Jangi, a rocket is fired at the plane. The return fire is both swift and lethal.
About every 2 to 3 minutes, there's a bombing run. And it seems like 500-pound bombs. There's also the sound of heavy machine gun fire.
Rockets and bullets scream over the house where Pelton is staying. The war is literally on top of him. With daybreak, Pelton will try to get to the fort, where the unexpected can erupt in a heartbeat. U.S. forces have been bombing the fort of Qali Jangi all night, taking fire from foreign prisoners who have overtaken part of the fortress from Northern Alliance troops. In the countryside, about a mile and a half from the fort, Pelton gets an early morning rude awakening.
I thought, well, I'd get up fresh and early and go see what's going on. And about 6 a.m., a rocket landed right next to the house. Just big bang, those 10-foot Uragan rockets. And that's an interesting wake-up call for your first morning in Afghanistan. And so I got out of bed, and the funniest thing I saw is that nobody slept that night. I was in an area that people lived in, and it was freezing cold. And they were all huddled and shivering, but they'd all come out to watch the bombing. Everybody sat there and went, ooh, ah, as each bomb hit the compound. So it was like watching television at 5:30, 6 in the morning. You know, I'd forgotten that Afghans have lived through 23 years of warfare. This isn't a big deal for them. This is just something that goes on a regular basis. But they were actually more interested in showing me the good things. And they had a large factory that produced urea, which is a fertilizer, using chemicals and natural gas. So they thought it would just be thrilling for me to go see this huge, foul-smelling urea plant. And the only advantage to me is that from the roof of this plant, which is right next door, I could see the fighting in the fortress that morning. And it was kind of a dual purpose, you know, sort of a dog and pony show plus a great camera vantage.
The war is close. And Pelton's hosts are nervous that events at the fort are not going their way. After putting up with the charade of the factory visit, Pelton pressures his guide to take him to the fort, just a 2-minute drive down the road. Northern Alliance guards pin down foreign fighters who have deceived their captors and attacked with grenades they hid under their clothing. The fighters grab heavy weapons and are holding out in the bunker-like basement of a pink house. The fire of assault weapons and rockets is intense. As Pelton moves closer to the fort, the air is filled with the sound of bullets.
There were people being shot and bullets flying and rockets being shot. So I felt it was safer to be up against the wall of the fort, which is where I was. This is a very, very random, sort of unpredictable type of combat. And you're fighting irregular troops. This isn't the trained army that's fighting here. This is a group of people wearing flip-flops and grabbing guns out of armories and just firing off rockets using homemade sort of mechanisms. And so what you have to do is you have to read the situation second by second.
It's believed some of the foreigners, many of them al Qaeda, had planned the uprising all along, killing Alliance commanders in suicide grenade attacks, and then looting the armories contained within the walls of the fort. Most of Dostum's troops are 5 hours away, and only a small band of guards fight for their lives. As Northern Alliance fighters desperately try to contain the foreigners inside the walls of the fort, U.S. troops outside the walls coordinate bombing runs with the Pink House as the target.
Over. Roger, be advised at this time, we're going on the building that's in the center of the compound house.
Something goes terribly wrong. The bomb misses its target and hits the command post instead, killing Afghans and injuring U.S. Special Forces. The intense fighting rages for 3 days as Pelton waits for his chance to get inside.
We're still cleaning up some people in the basement or the lower area. And there's a few stray rounds flying around. But they're still cleaning up, as they say. Because we're not allowed inside, but later on we'll go inside and see what happens.
General Dostum, deeply concerned with what is happening at Qali Jangi, is on his way to the fortress. Pelton must convince him that he be allowed access to the war, even though victory or defeat hangs in the balance. Under cover of darkness, General Dostum's SUV pulls into his personal compound on the outskirts of Mazar. Surrounded by an elite force of bodyguards, this is the man who can allow Pelton access or have him arrested and expelled with a snap of his fingers.
When I was talking to Dostum that evening when he showed up and he was tired and grubby, he wanted to know what my goal was or why I was here. And I said, I just want to see what's happening here. I want to understand the conflict. I want to understand what you're trying to do and also who you are.
Dostum surprises Pelton by inviting him into his personal compound. The rarely interviewed warlord has never allowed an outsider this close. Now it's Pelton's move. He has to earn Dostum's trust, and so far, no journalist has been able to do that.
By having a relationship with someone who's in charge, you can learn more about the country and get to know people. But the other thing, this is a country in flux and sort of a historical moment in time. Does he have any involvement with the fighting in the south? You know, the new fighting with the Taliban? Does he have to get involved in it?
Dostum likes Pelton's bold, direct style and begins to tell him his side of the story and offers Pelton his version of what needs to be done in the war against terrorism. The Western media portrays Dostum as a brutal warlord, but as Pelton spends more time with this leader, he begins to gather his own facts. and forms a different picture.
You realize that he puts his pants on just like we do, and he has a wife and kids, and he's got bills to pay, and he's got problems and worries and dreams like everybody else, and he's a very human person. And when you ask him about some of the atrocities or some of the things that have been attributed to him, he can explain very clearly what actually happened. And obviously he's been a military commander most of his life, so he's been involved in a lot of very ugly things. And one of the things I remember him saying is that people always say that you're brutal and that you're a warlord. And he said, well, I'd be very surprised if they said I was kind and gentle, you know, because when you're a commander and you win, they're not going to say nice things about you. So, I mean, I appreciate that he's been involved in a lot of bloodletting and killing and violent things. But I also understand as a man that his goal is not war, it's peace.
After the intense struggle to quell the prison uprising, Dostum inspects what is left of his headquarters at the Qali Jangi fortress. Pelton is along to witness the violent effects of war. Neither man is prepared for the carnage they are about to see. The fortress at Qali Jangi was the location of one of the most intense battles in the war against terrorism. Over 200 men are dead, hundreds wounded before Dostum's troops finally defeat the uprising. What you are about to see is disturbing and not for children.
This was an ancient fortress which was the site of the bombardment and also the battle between Taliban prisoners and their guards. And what you're seeing is the aftermath of about a 24-hour bombing run and also fairly intense fighting. Sounds that we heard that night were emanating from this fort. And the casualties are still here, and the Red Cross is still has to count how many bodies there are. But there seems to be a significant number of Taliban bodies strewn around the compound, much more than 50. And it took them 2 days to clear this out before it was safe enough for us to go in with General Dostum.
There was a smell of death everywhere. There were people blown to bits, and there were people with their brains spread out. I mean, it was these people had been hit by very, you know, massive weapons. When you first come on the scene of a battle, the thing that strikes you is the waste. I mean, there were just so many bodies that it almost looked like a movie set. I mean, they were just sprawled everywhere, you know, hiding in the grass and spread out on the fields and inside buildings. And there were little sort of cinematic things like feet stuck in shoes. Or I remember one man was sort of, had sort of a very peaceful look in his face, except half of his head had been crushed by a tank, and so the rest of his head was splattered all over the mud. And so my initial reaction was it was a very inglorious way to die. I take pictures, I don't hide behind the camera. I mean, it's a way to record, because a lot of times people just, they can't even imagine what you're looking at. And I think it's important to document things and to put them on film or videotape. This fortress was used as an armory, and there were tons and tons of weapons, bullets, bombs, grenades, landmines, fuses.
Shocked at the carnage and violence, Dostum tells Pelton that in his 23 years of war, he's never witnessed a more horrific scene. Pelton carefully reconstructs the last minutes of Mike Spann, an armed CIA agent who was beaten to death and finally shot by prisoners. Span was America's first combat casualty in this war.
In the central pink building where these fighters had taken their sort of last stand, there was a basement. And so a number of these al Qaeda fighters had taken refuge in the basement. And they knew there were a number of bodies there because you could smell the rotting corpses. So then they spent about 5 days trying to kill what they thought were two or three people in this basement. Now this basement has a central, has a stairwell, and then it has a central corridor, and then it has rooms that come off the central corridor. And each room has an air vent. And what they were doing is they were firing weapons down these little air vents, and they were shooting rockets, large 10-foot rockets. They would line them up and then slide them in there and fire the fuse, and this rocket would go in and explode inside this cement basement. And then they knew there were still people down there. And then they started to come up with other ideas. And one of the other ideas was to pour fuel or gasoline or diesel down into the bunker and then light it and burn them out. And they knew that killed some people. So they also brought in a water truck and they started pouring ice cold water into this basement. And for about, I guess, almost 20 hours, the basement started filling up with freezing cold water. And you can imagine the scene in this basement. It's pitch black, and there's dead bodies floating in this water, and there's mud. There's people screaming. So all the wounded people drowned. And finally, people yelled, and then they started to come up. And they were shocked. I mean, these people had actually survived 7 days in this basement. Apparently, some of them used to sneak up at night and cut pieces of meat off the dead horses and take it down to eat. And they drank the water that was floating with the dead bodies and the mud and the human waste. I can't imagine a more horrific experience than that.
In the pitch-black basement, every step is crucial. The floor is littered with unexploded ordnance. A grenade left behind could be a trap. And remnants of a final, desperate struggle can be seen in the dim light of a flashlight.
Hey, look at this. There's fingerprints up here. Holy Jesus, what does that mean? There's fingerprints higher than I can stand. This is where over 100 Al Qaeda fighters held out or hid for a week at Qali Jangi. And after a week, 86 came up, but there were a number down here that drowned or died of their wounds. And this is the first time that somebody's actually walked around and seen the conditions that they're in. And it's rather stark. There's a room that's completely blackened. There's writing on the wall where they were writing the different names of the various Talib mullahs, drawings of flowers. You can imagine when the water came in the middle of winter and it started climbing and it drowned the wounded first. And then the rest were left to stand for 20 hours in freezing water and then finally decided to go up to the light. But at that point, this was probably the world's most dangerous place. But I can't imagine spending 7 days down in this place.
Pelton walks the ground where no outsider has gone before. In the very rooms where desperate fighters had stayed alive under intense bombardment. Little did Pelton know, he is about to discover a survivor of this hellish place who would send shockwaves back to America. After the violent battle of Qali Jangi, Pelton learns there are thousands of prisoners being transported 3 hours away to Dostum's hometown of Sherbagan. It is a potentially explosive situation. Dostum fights a war against Taliban troops who had fled to the hills, and now he has to worry about thousands of prisoners who have just been involved in an armed uprising and are placed in tight quarters. Into this situation, Pelton enters, coming face to face with Taliban and Al Qaeda fighters against the better judgment of his guides.
Since he had surrendered his weapon, how has he been treated? We're at Sherbagan prison, and this is where 3,500 Taliban prisoners have been assembled, awaiting
instructions or orders from General Dostum as to whether they'll be sent back or kept here. But as you can see, it's an extraordinary sight to see 3,500 men in a space this small.
The Taliban have put a $50,000 bounty on the head of any U.S. citizen, dead or alive. Yet Pelton needs to see for himself the men who are prepared to die in their quest to kill Americans.
So the Taliban is finished.
The Taliban finished.
Finished, okay. So the Taliban is finished. Which...
Yeah,
exactly. They say they came here to help. And it's funny because I was with the Taliban in 1995 and saw the beginnings of the Taliban, and this is pretty much the remnants of the end of the Taliban. I was with the Taliban in 1995. I mean, I know them very well, and I met their leadership, and I was out in the front lines with them. They always were sort of a ramshackle grassroots organization. For the people that you meet in that prison are Afghans who think they're fighting a civil war, but there's also foreigners who think they're fighting a holy war, jihad, which to them is more of a global conflict. So in terms of what do I think of them now, I think a lot of them were very naive. Most of them are young, you know, between 18 and 20. They were told that it's a noble thing to fight a jihad, or what's called a struggle. When they got here, they found that the war was quite ugly and that they weren't really serving any purpose.
It is at Sherbagan that Pelton comes face to face with a young American who would ignite a firestorm of controversy and be one of the most stunning stories of the war. The fighters, who were injured in the uprising at Qali Jangi, are taken to a local hospital, where one of Dostum's men breathlessly runs to see Pelton. There's an American among the wounded.
There were three Green Berets, and I jumped in a truck and we drove to the hospital. And there was an emergency or an admitting ward, which is not really what it was. It was just a room with a small stove and about 18 men just sort of crowding every inch of floor. And a lot of these men, one man had his face shot off, another one had his jaw missing. A lot of them had large chest wounds, just huge gashes in their arms. And they were suffering from being in freezing cold water, and they were starving, they were hungry.
Pelton enters the makeshift triage room. The warm smell of gangrene and human waste strikes him hard.
And so I had to walk very carefully to get over these men without stepping on them. And in the background, the doctor was whacking this one man on the head, saying, "What is your name? What is your name?
What is your name? Huh? The American's name. Huh? John, the father's name. From? Where are you from? Washington, D.C.? Which part of Washington, D.C.? Huh? Which part of Washington, D.C.? Open your eyes. Huh?
Northwest.
What?
Northwest.
Northwest?
Northwest Washington.
No, no, we're seeing. How many months ago you came in Afghanistan?
Can I ask him the questions? Hey, John. This is Robert Pelton.
Huh?
Where were you born?
As I said, Northwest.
What?
D.C.
Huh?
Washington, D.C.
Washington, D.C. Can you tell us if you have family in America?
All of my family is in America.
And what is your mother and father's name?
And I started talking to this person, and he was almost comatose, and his hair was sticking straight out, and he had a beard, and his face was blackened. I didn't know what type of injuries he had, but he looked in bad shape.
Yes. Oh. We want to contact your parents to let them know you're still alive.
I'd rather contact them through the Red Cross.
You want to talk to the Red Cross?
If I were to contact them, I would contact them if I have a reliable source of information.
So you want to speak to the Red Cross?
Later.
Would you like an American trained medic to look at you? John?
If they're
available. Yes, they're here right now.
And an American has been found in the basement of Qali Jangi prison and brought here.
Robert Young Pelton is about to videotape a conversation that would open a door into the world of the Taliban and Osama bin Laden.
We took him to a separate room, and then we gave him an IV because he was very cold and his skin was white.
Abdul, can I ask how you ended up here? I'd love to hear it.
If you pass a different time, I could give you a better answer.
Okay, I'll let you take. I'll let you concentrate on what you're doing.
That wasn't the first American that I'd met that had been fighting in the jihad, but it was the first person that had survived that type of ordeal and didn't seem to want any help.
You look like you were very close to being unhelpable, so I got these men to come down and try to render some aid to you.
The next morning, John Walker Lindh is taken into American custody. Seven months after lying wounded on a stretcher, John Walker Lindh would plead guilty to carrying a rifle and two grenades and fighting on the side of the Taliban army. He was sentenced to up to 20 years in an American prison. Even though Dostum negotiated the surrender of thousands of enemy fighters, the war is far from over. Afghanistan remains a very dangerous place. With each day and each action, General Dostum allows Pelton to be at his side, giving him exclusive access to the war against terrorism. Dostum has nothing to hide from the camera as Pelton documents the details of his covert operations.
I was glad that I was here to see things with my own eyes. And the thing I kept hearing over and over again was, you know, what you see will be the truth. He never said, this is the truth. He always said, what you see is the truth. And I found that was very, very refreshing and a very positive sign.
Pelton leaves the scene where almost 3,500 Taliban and foreign fighters are crammed into a Soviet-era prison. It seemed to most outsiders that the war had come to an abrupt end in northern Afghanistan. And then, just as quickly, the landscape of war shifts again.
The mood changed quickly because all of a sudden the war was not over. Then I found out that, oh, by the way, there's 3,000 Taliban 10 kilometers from here. And it was like, whoa. One of the Taliban commanders had escaped. There were three Taliban commanders in Kunduz, and two had surrendered, but there was one named Mullah Dadullah, a man with one leg and one eye, and was called the Black Mullah because he was apparently a very cruel man. He had actually hung five people the day before Dostum came into Mazar.
The Taliban force still occupies the city of Balkh, Alexander the Great's old walled capital, a few miles west of Mazar. It is left to Dostum to clean up the region's last remaining pocket of Taliban. Intelligence is sketchy as to how big a Taliban force Dostum now faces.
The first day I was told, okay, there's 80 Taliban hiding in this area. And then on the way there, they said, no, there's actually 500. And then when we got there, the commander said, no, there's 3,000, fully armed, ready to have a fight.
Dostum plays his troops like a chess game, moving pieces around the board until the enemy is surrounded. The waiting game begins. With truck-mounted anti-aircraft guns dropped to eye level, 20 Ergun missiles point toward the village. Dostum's strategy is clear. Negotiate with a show of strength and the reputation of being able to carry out the threat of violence.
I expected a hellacious firefight. But Dostum chose to negotiate, which I thought was interesting, and he let deadlines pass. And I was very much impressed that this man knew how to fight war, whether it took negotiation or whether it took violence.
General Dostum, a man both feared and respected throughout Afghanistan, is negotiating the short-term future of Balkh and the men inside.
In this building, this military compound, General Rashid Dostum is negotiating with Pashtun commanders to push out a group of about 300 mercenaries, or they call them mercenaries, but foreign fighters that are in town. And it remains to be seen whether he'll be successful. The deadline has passed, which was noon, and they're still in negotiations. If they don't come to some kind of agreement, there'll be an assault launched on these men.
It takes almost a full day, but Dostum achieves a peaceful surrender. Not all victories are achieved through bloodshed. This would be one town in a long list of towns that Dostum's forces, along with a small cadre of Green Berets, take over, with the only shots being fired coming from Pelton's cameras. After the standoff at Balkh, Dostum goes home to pay respects to his father. Pelton follows, documenting the spot where Dostum built his first stronghold to guard the village. In the surrounding hillside lie the tombs of the men who helped guard the sites. Now he stands alone. Within a week, Dostum is named Deputy Minister of Defense in Afghanistan's new government, and Pelton will extend his travels, journeying deeper into Afghanistan, discovering that there are few places where the specter of war has not touched the country or the people.
These are some of the craters from the bombs. These would probably be a 500-pound bomb, but you can see the casing. You can see how jagged it is, how it breaks off.
War stories resonate with every step of his journeys into the countryside. Afghanistan hasn't changed much since the days of Genghis Khan.
Afghanistan never really changes. I mean, this countryside probably looked like this in 1200 AD. People live in mud houses. They use, you know, donkeys and horses. They eat simple food. There's no technology here. The only technology we saw was a generator-powered TV playing bad movies. And these people find Westerners fascinating. We have funny clothes, we talk funny, we do funny things. And they're just fascinated by us. So you have more dangers here than you have sitting in your lounger at home. But the thing that's so wonderful about here is that those dangers keep people out. And so what you're seeing here are people that, many of them are seeing a Westerner for the first time. They just really enjoy the idea of someone coming to visit them, and they're very hospitable, and it's a wild, open, rugged, undiscovered place.
The landscape of Afghanistan is diverse and rugged. It's a country that makes you forget that for a quarter of a century it's been scarred by war, until you step off a ledge and are reminded that the remnants of war can be found even in the most scenic postcard pictures.
What I've done is I've run off the road to take a scenic shot of this canyon down here, and I've been notified by the guard that this area is heavily mined. It was mined by the Taliban a few months ago. But it's fairly normal to find yourself in mined areas, not necessarily this far out in an area that's mined, but the important thing is when I got here, I didn't hit a mine. So what I've got to do now is find my footprints and retrace my way back to the road. The other thing you can look for is animals and people will usually beat a path, and it's rained here recently, so if there's a hard beaten path, the chances are you can follow that path and get out. So what I'm going to try to do is, because my boots have a distinctive tread, is find my tracks, which is not as easy as it sounds. And I'm going to stay on the hard pressed part of this hill. When I skidded down the hill there, I noticed I left some tracks there. See, I came down this way. Let's see. Looks like this is the best way.
What?
One safety tip here. When your guard offers you the butt of his rifle, don't necessarily grab onto it.
Afghanistan is one of the most heavily mined countries in the world. Some estimate, at the current removal rate, it will take 20,000 years to remove all the mines. The Russians buried and dropped about 12 million mines. And when the Taliban took power, they continued blanketing the country, even the rivers, which are a horrific hideout for explosives. The mines tend to drift with the current. What was in one spot one day is in another spot the next. And no one really knows where it's safe to traverse.
Everybody's waiting here because they're a little nervous. Because they actually don't know which is the right way to cross the water.
Pelton would find out again how heavily mined the country is when the Jeep he's driving in makes a sudden stop.
We were driving down the river and our driver kept getting stuck. So he wanted to try the main road, which runs along the side. And I kept saying, gee, I don't see any tracks on this road. And he kept driving and these two old guys were running after us. And then we found out later they were yelling, mine, mine. And finally our driver saw some red rocks, so he stopped. And now we're going to go back onto the river to drive.
At every twist and turn, the horrors of war are revealed. The victims, so often children, suffer the choices of men. The story is recorded, lessons are learned. And Pelton's journey to the world's most dangerous places continues.
What you learn from doing this type of travel, or from this type of goal, is that first of all, the world is round. Everybody's your neighbor. You know, that we always think that there's an imaginary line between countries. There isn't. Maybe people speak a different language or they have a different cultural background, but they all have the same goals and needs and desires and wants. And we tend to insulate ourselves on the Western side of things because we have everything. You know, we have food, we have security, we have safety, we have money. And we seem to think that there's some kind of wall that says, well, that doesn't relate to us. That doesn't, you know, if people are starving here or people are fighting a war, it's not my problem. You know, I've got my own worries. I've got to make car payments. But what happened on September 11th is we realized that those problems come back to haunt us. And that Afghanistan is, as remote as it is, it's on the other side of the world, all of a sudden became very relevant. We never thought our troops would be fighting a war in Afghanistan, and here we are. So the thing I learned is that we fool ourselves sometimes. We think that we don't need to pay attention to world events, but we do. And more importantly, we need to take the time we have to go to these places and listen to these people and share food with them and meet their kids and just understand what life is like for them so that when we come back to our sort of privileged existence, we make decisions with those people in mind.